I work at the Wigner Research Center for Physics of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences. I was actually a physicist, so, and my field was general relativity. Therefore, my first machine was named Black Hole, and thus came my email address. Actually, if you could watch the news yesterday, the LIGO experiment announced that, yeah, the gravitational waves were detected first time ever, and 100 years later, Einstein predicted it. It's a very big news and breakthrough in science, and waves was actually generated by two colliding black holes. Okay, but back to our topic. In this presentation, I will talk about IPsec, which is a tool to build faster and more efficient firewalls with IP tables. When I refer to IP tables, I mean IP tables and IPsec tables together, just to speak shortly. The main challenges are the large number of rules, or often changed rules. IP tables evaluate the rules linearly, so for example, thousands of rules in a same chain means slower processing for any rule after this chain. Also, IP tables cannot add, delete, or replace a single rule. The whole table must be constructed and replaced with the old one, which just requires much more resources. Let's focus on the most common cases. Usually, we have large number of rules in the filter table where we implement and express or network security policy. The typical rules in a filter table say which IP address or net block have access or denied access to a given service running on a given IP address or net block. So we match on the protocol and port numbers, the source and destination addresses at most and in large number of rules. So with IPsec, we will try to solve these common cases only. Actually, IPsec had a predecessor called IP pool, which was written by Joachim Axelsson in 2000. IP pool made possible to match IPv4 addresses in a bitmap. Patrick Schaaf and Joachim Axelsson joined the development on IP pool, and in 2002 it was modular, and they introduced a new set type in which one can could match IPv4 addresses and MAC address pairs in a pool. Actually, when I discovered IP pool, I was quite fascinated about the idea to store data in pools and matching in pools. So first I sent some small patches, bug fixes and corrections, and then later on some huge patches which wanted to change the system really. And due to backward incompatibilities in 2004, actually Patrick Schaaf suggested to give a new name to the system I shaped, and this is how IPsec and the name was born. The current IPsec main version number is 6, which was released first in 2011 after an almost complete rewriting of the whole system. So what is actually IPsec? IPsec gives possible to store data sets in the kernel and provides the API to look up, add or delete elements from these sets. A given list of data types can be stored in the set or given combination of them, so IP address only or network address only or network blocks and interface name pairs or IP address and port number and IP address tuples and so on. The API is of course not restricted to IP tables alone, so for example Florian Vespa wrote a TC EM match to match IP addresses in IP sets from TC. IPsec provides a few storage methods to choose from, the original bitmap, the hash type and lists. We will look into them in detail later. Also, every set type supports different kind of extensions. Which can be added to every set element like timeout values or packet and byte counters or comments or SKB info related metadata. The set has got dimensions, which means how many sub-elements form an element in the set, 1, 2, or 3. This information is important for us in order to use the sets from IP tables or other external systems. Of course, we need a user space tool to manage the sets in the kernel. It is called IPSet. The binary has a very minimal library dependency on libmnl, which is the minimalistic netlink library written by Pablo. It's very small, very tiny library, so the whole tool is very, very, very small. The IPSet tool, starting from version 6.0, has got a similar command line syntax than the TC tool. So if you know TC, then you are quite familiar with IPSet at once. But the original IPSet syntax was kept for backward compatibility reasons. So all system syntax can still be used with IPSet. We have a few commands to manage the sets. We can, of course, create them or destroy or list the sets. We can save all sets in the command line syntax and then restore them in one, with one command. We can flush the set so that all elements are destroyed in the set. We can rename a set, or we can even swap two sets so that A set is swapped by B, then B will point to A and A will point to B, and it's atomic operation in the sense of IP tables. The set elements are managed by the add, delete, and test commands, of course, and all commands has got single letter equivalents just to spare typing if you want to give commands fast, and you can use single letter equivalents. Sometimes you'll use those kind of syntax just to fit on the screen line in this presentation. Okay, let's see a simple example about the syntax. In order to create a set, we must specify the storage method beside the unique name and the data type stored in the set. So in this example, we create a set named test, which has got a hash storage method, and it can store a triple of the data in IP addresses, ports, and IP addresses. It is an IPv4 kind of set because we didn't specify we want IPv6 kind of IP addresses stored in the set. We can add and delete test elements easily. IPSet supports to look up host names in the command line, but unfortunately at the moment it uses only the first IP address when multiple ones are returned by the DNS lookup. Okay, let's see the different storage methods. The bitmap type is actually quite the same as what was implemented in IP pool by Joachim Axelsson, and it supports only IPv4 addresses. We store elements from a range in a bit vector where every bit represents one element and one IP address. If a given bit is on, then the corresponding IPv address is in the set. Quite simple and extremely fast, so I cannot imagine anything else which could be faster to match in a set. The method could be easily generalized to store same size IPv4 addresses, same size IPv4 net blocks, or IPv4 addresses and MAC address pairs where the MAC addresses are stored in a different separated vector. Or we can store TCP or UDP port numbers. This is just for fun. The maximal number of elements in a bitmap type of set is limited to 65,536, which is actually can cover the full IPv4 address space in /16 size net blocks, or it can cover the full possible TCP or UDP port numbers. So the bitmap IP type can be used to store just IPv4 addresses or same size IPv4 net blocks from a range. When we define the set, we must define the range we want to store in the set, either in the range notation or in a net block notation. In the first example, we store just simple IP addresses in the range. In the second one, we store /16 size net blocks in this bitmap type of set. In practice, there are places where they use the bitmap IP type just to store in a set the clients in the internal network which can have access to the internet, for example. The internal network is usually some kind of IPv4 address space, and which is continuous usually, and it can be quite easily represented in a single bitmap IP set. The bitmap IP MAC type is a variation of the bitmap IP type, where we store MAC address and IPv4 address pairs. It is possible to add an element to such a set without specifying the MAC address, in which case the first packet, which is matched by the IP address, will be taken and the MAC address will be filled out from this packet in the set. So we are not required to know the MAC addresses in advance. We can fill it out automatically from the first matching packets. For example, we have a guest Wi-Fi network at our institute and with a captive portal style of Wi-Fi access. So if a client wants to connect to any external website, we redirect the client to our captive portal web page when they have to access the local policy, enter a keyword, and after that we add the IP address as MAC address to the pair of the client to bitmap IP MAC set. And then we redirect the client to the original web space. And from the set, we can then identify that we saw this client and can grant access to the client to the internet. Even we can define timeouts due to the timeout extension, how long this access is granted to the client. Actually, the portal side of Wi-Fi access, the hotel could be implemented with IPsec as easily.
Maybe it is?
I don't know. Okay, hashing. Hashing is a well-known method to look up random data. We map the input data into a fixed data space where the mapping algorithm must be deterministic, so the it returns the same output for the same input, and it should be uniform, that is, it should map the input data as evenly as possible into the output range. The default hash function in the Linux kernel is the ghash, which is actually the lookup tree function written by Bob Jenkins, and I suggested to use this lookup function in the Linux kernel after quite a lot of testing. It's a quite good and excellent hash function. Collision is normal in a hashing method and usually is handled by linked lists in the hash buckets. The hash method in IPsec is quite optimized for speed. So, therefore, if the input hash size provided by the user is rounded up to the first next power 2 value, which is the optimal for hashing in the case of ghash. Also, the collided elements are stored in an array instead of linked lists, because with the arrays we have a continuous memory to look up, and we have a chance that the data is on the CPU cache line, which is absolutely not guaranteed and doesn't happen with linked lists. The initial array can hold 4 data in the hash bucket, and it grows automatically up to 12 elements. If you want to put more elements in this hash bucket, then the whole hash will be doubled and resized automatically. In order to prevent some kind of attack vector, the automatic doubling of the hash doesn't happen when the elements are added from the kernel API functions like the set target. So the hash is doubled only if we add the elements from the user space. This is just the prevention so that attackers cannot fill up a set easily and exhaust your memory easily, because there is no limit how many elements are added to a set. Okay, the hash IP method, when we store just IP addresses in a set. The hash family fully supports IPv4 or IPv6, so we can define any kind of sets to store this kind of addresses. The hash IP type also can store same size networks or net blocks. So in the first example, we store just random IPv4 addresses in our set. And in the second example, we store random 64-sized net blocks, IPv6 net blocks in our set. And here you can see how we have to specify the family we want to use as a set in the hash type of set. The hash method was extended to support to store different size net blocks too. It is not trivial for a hash to store and look up different size net blocks in a hash. There is one restriction: one cannot store /0 size net blocks in a hash net type of set, mainly because it would mean an element with full zero parts, and full zero means empty slot in the array. And also because it doesn't make much sense to add the zero size net block because it covers the full address space for IPv4, IPv6. But the net type supports the no-match keyword by which one can add holes into holder larger net blocks in a set. So you can say that I want to match a /16 size net block, but I do not want to match a smaller net block in this huge address space. I want to explore the /24 size net block. It is actually recursive, so you can put a matching hole into the smaller hole and a non-matching hole into an even smaller hole into it. So it's quite possible and supported. So you can put holes and so you can manage what kind of address ranges you want to support in net blocks and store in a hash kind of net, hash kind of set. The lookup time for a fully non-matching element is actually proportional to a different size of net blocks in a hash net type of set. For example, if we want to match 2.1.2.2.2 in this kind of set, we first have to look up /24 size of net block in this, and if it is not found in the set, we will continue with a /16 size of net block. We cannot find that in the set as well, so then we can return safely the return this is not in the set, and we have a no-match value at the end. The hash method supports to store porn kind of data as a sub-element when we form doubles or triples. Actually, a port keyword is kept for backward compatibility reason only. It means protocol and port number together. So if it doesn't specify the protocol, it means a TCP port. If you use ICMP or ICMP version 6, then it means a type and code value or a keyword like ping. You'll see some examples in the next slides. Just to summarize all of the possible hash types you can choose from, we have quite a lot of different kind of hash kind of sets. Just to pick which is the best for the given case and store the different kind of data, singles, doubles, and triples. Okay, let's see an example. Let's say you want to store all of our public services in a single set. I mean public services which is available for everyone on the internet. There is no access control regarding the clients. We can add IP address and port pairs. And so in this example, we list 192.168.1.1, which can be pinged. It's actually a DNS server which serves over TCP and UDP. And 192.168.1.4 is actually SMTP server, which can be reached over the standard SMTP port and the submission port, and so on. So all your public services can be listed in a single set. And then you can use the single set in a single IP tables rule to match and allow the access from the internet. There's one more interesting hash type, the hashnet iface, in which case we can store net block and interface pairs in a set. And in this kind of set, you can actually store /0 size net blocks, both for IPv4 and IPv6. This set was designed to make possible easier to cover egress and egress filtering for your firewall. You can list actually your zones, network zones, from which interface the network zone can be seen as a source address. For example, in this set, 192.168.1.0 will match only if it arrives from the tenant 1 named network interface. It arrives from the tenant 2 or the WAN, it won't match. So you can easily use a set to express ingress and egress filtering with one simple set. The last storage method is list. It has got a single type, list set, which gives us the possibility to define supersets, which has the elements of subsets. Actually, it's quite simple. When the sets are stored in linked lists and the first match wins, so we can look up different sets one after another in the superset. Any kind of set can be put in a superset, so IPv4 and IPv6 can be mixed. There's no restriction in this kind. You can put IPv4 kind of hash sets in the superset and IPv6 kind of hash sets as well. Let's see the extensions in more detail. Timeout extension, it means what it says. The elements times out automatically from the set. Therefore, a garbage collector runs periodically for a given set just to free up the timeout entries. The extension must be specified at set creation time with a default timeout value. Of course, you can add elements with non-default timeout values as you want. There's not restrictions. For example, in this example, we had the first element with a larger timeout value and the second one with a zero timeout value. The zero is exceptional, which means that please, this element is permanent. It shouldn't be expired from the set. So you can store in the same set timing out entries and non-timing out entries as well. And in the third example, we get the element and we just let the default timeout value to be used, which was defined at set creation time to be 600 seconds. When we add elements to a set by the set target, and the set was defined with the timeout extension, the elements will be added, of course, with the default timeout value to the set when we add it with the set target. Of course, this is a quite trivial way to create ban sets against attackers, port scanners, and any other guy who want to slow down or simply deny access to our services or networks. The comment extension is quite simple. It makes possible to attach comment to any set element. The comment has no whatsoever meaning for the kernel. It is just for the humans or third party or external systems which use IPsec. Counter extension is also quite simple. It adds byte and packet counters to the set elements. And whenever an element is matched by the kernel, then these counters are updated. We can add elements with predefined counter values when we fill up the set with the elements, of course. Otherwise, all the counters start from zero. When we save the set, of course, the counter values are saved as well, so we can restore the set with the previous counter values when we save our set. The skbinfo extension is quite interesting. It makes possible to store skbuf-related metadata together with the set elements, and then we can use the set target to attach these elements to the matching packets. The SKB marker specifies the normal firewall mark value with an optional mask. The SKB prio makes possible to store and restore TC class values in major and minor format, and the SKB Q parameter makes possible to store and attach hardware queue numbers to the matching buckets. Okay, we haven't covered actually how IPSet is used from IP tables, how the two systems interact, because the two systems are actually quite independent from each other. So we refer to the sets from the IP tables rules with either the set match or the set target, and IP tables has no idea whatsoever what kind of set it will use. It knows only the name of the set and what kind of directions of a given parameter should be fetched by IP set from the packet to construct the element we want to look up. And the direction parameters must be at least as many as the dimension of the set. So let's see again our services set in which we wanted to store all our public services. Then we can refer to this set with this IP tables rule. When we tell to IPSet, please fetch the destination IP address from the packet, the destination port from the packet, form the double, and look at this double in the set. And that's it. So IP tables doesn't know anything about the kind of set, bitmap, hash, list, nothing. It only knows what kind of direction parameters must be fetched from the packet to look at the data in the set. Sometimes the direction parameter has no meaning. For example, I listed the set when we can store mark values. Of course, the mark value has no direction meaning in a packet. So you can use a source or destination, no problem which one you want to use. Okay. What happens if you specify less direction parameter than the dimension of the set? In that case, that operation has no meaning for IPSet, therefore the match will not match ever, because the set hasn't got enough parameters. What kind of data should I look up? I don't know. If you specify more direction parameters, then the unnecessary ones are simply ignored, because that way we can use the list kind of set so that we can put different dimensional sets into the list kind of superset. So in this example, we have a list kind of set with two subsets, and we match the first one, it's called restricted services, which is a three-dimensional set. And in the match, we specify that please look at the destination IP address, the destination port, and the source IP address from the packet, form the triple, and look up in the set. If you cannot find anything, there is no result, then please continue with the next set, which is a two-dimensional set. So please look at the destination IP address, destination port from the packet only, ignore the third parameter because it's a two-dimensional set, form the double and look up the set element in that set. Okay, the set target was already mentioned. It makes possible to add or delete elements from a set dynamically, and also it makes possible to attach the SKB info metadata to the matching packets. So, a simple skeleton to how to block scanners with timeout combined in the set. We have a simple scanner set, and we just jump to the deny chain when we first add the attacker or the scanner to the set, then log the action, and then just drop the packet. And then we can easily fill up the set and refer to it in another rule by IP tables. Actually, we use it in practice, and we constantly, we have 3,000-5,000 blocked IP addresses in the set. Sometimes we have 30 or 40,000. There are some waves in attacks sometimes and scanners. It works quite reliably. Of course, you have to pick the timeout value properly if you want just to slow down the attackers, and also you just want to let in your own users when they accidentally want to access internal protected servers from home, and therefore they are banned for half an hour or something like that. It sometimes happens when they forget to start the VPN from home, they want to come directly, and then this method picks them and put them on the ban list. Okay, I mentioned that there is a swapping possibility in IPsec. It is important because IP tables refers to sets by internal ID. So we can quite easily swap two sets so that the operation is looks like atomic or like a transaction from IP tables point of view. So you refer to the set in your almost never changing IP tables rules, and you want to modify this set like a transaction. Then you define a new temporary set, fill out as you want, and at the end you just swap the two sets, which is atomic operation. And then you destroy the temporary set because the temporary set is actually no identical with the previous in production set. It is absolutely like a transaction. Until you destroy this temporary set at the end, you anytime can go back and undo all of your operations or just let the original set unmodified and intact. So, Pablo is not here, unfortunately. NFTables has got also a set functionality. Let's compare the two animals, IP set and the sets in NFTables. I hope I'm correct, so if someone knows I am mistaken, then just please shout and correct me. Let's start with the data what you can store in these kind of sets. Here are the lists which are supported with IPSet and which are supported by NFTables. Actually, IPSet can store IPv4 and IPv6 netbox and mark values and interface names and set names which are not supported yet in NFTables. I think at least interface names or IDs and mark values could be quite easily to NFTables. Netblocks, it is not so easy. It will take a little bit more time. In IPSet, you have fixed combinations of the data when you want to form doubles or triples. But in the case of NFTables, you can have arbitrary combinations, so you are not restricted to the predefined set types. You can come up with anything with the concatenation of data in NFTables. IPSet supports only named sets. In NFTables, you may have anonymous sets, but anonymous sets is actually fixed. You cannot modify them later, so it's just a fixed data or a shortcut notation. IPSet has got extensions like timeout, comment, counters, skbinfo. In NFTables, you have two extensions like attribute to sets, timeout, and comment, and no counters at set element level in NFTables. But in NFTables, you have maps and dictionaries, and map is something like the SKB info in IPSet, but it's much more functionality. And there is no such thing like dictionaries in IPSet because we don't know how to jump to a subchain in IP tables or like that, or return. We could return defined value like accept or drop, that is possible in IPSet too, but we cannot change, we cannot jump to a given chain in IP tables because there are two separate systems. We should create, we should bump like reference numbers to the chain so it cannot be destroyed later, so it's not possible for IPSet. IPSet supports different kind of storage methods, and as far as I know, NFTables set supports only the hash method yet. But other types I planned, and as far as I know, they don't plan to expose the storage method to the user. So when I talk to Pablo, they think it is not important for the user to know what kind of set will be used. System will figure out which is the best. And these are two different conceptions. From IPSet point of view, you have the knowledge and you are the guy who knows how to fit the system best to your environment. And in NFTables, mostly the system tried to help you and figure out instead of you. The hash implementation is quite different in the two systems. In IPSet, we use arrays to solve the clashing elements in the hash bucket, and in NFTables, they use the classical lists, linked lists in a hash bucket. Also, NFTables use the rhash table algorithm method, which makes possible for the sets in NFTable to shrink and grow automatically. While in IPSet, the sets can only grow and not shrink. This is a big difference as well. So IPSet and the sets are NFTables are not fully compatible. You can find intersections which can be implemented with either of the systems, but there are cases which are just not compatible to each other. Performance. Unfortunately, Jasper is just giving a talk parallel with me, and Jasper who measured the IPSet performance about a year ago. He compared IPSet actually to IP tables with a simple matching rule. So first he measured this IP tables in the row table with a single matching IP tables rule and just dropped the packet. So nothing other overhead was. So no accept, no forwarding, no other net stack or net filter stack operation, just drop the packet on the floor. That was the first which he measured, and then he created a set, a hash type of set with 65 key elements and replaced the rules with another bunch of rules with a single match in this set with the sourced IP address in this hash set with 65 key elements. And his generator could send 12.2 million packets per second, and IP tables could match 11.30 million packets per second in this special case. At that time, I was working on the RCU integration in IPSet, so he compared the IPSet without RCU, and in the case it could cope with 8 million packets per second. And after the RCU was complete in IPSet, it could reach 11.30 million packets per second, which is quite good, I think, compared that IPSet wanted to match a single IP address in the net block, and IPSet had to match 65K elements in a set.
Is there a difference in CPU utilization?
I don't know. Ask Jasper. So he knows the details about it. He just sent me the results, and I was happy about the results. I don't know the equipment he used and CPU usage and so on. But he will be happy to, I think, to tell you any details about his testings. Okay. So that's it. Thank you. Happy firewalling with the IPSet, and thanks again. Yeah?
So you mentioned that IP sets are only growable, whereas NFTable set can grow and shrink both.
Yes.
So is it possible, or is it in the future scope that IP set can also have that ability to shrink?
It could be added. It is not an impossible operation in IP set. It was never requested to make possible to shrink the set. So it was easier just to watch that we have to grow the set and not shrink it. Okay, thanks. Okay, hi.
Regarding the matching of interface names in IPSet,
yes.
Do you really sort of keep the strings of the interface names, or do you translate to IF indexes?
You are right. This is a very good question, because it is much slower to match the interface name compared to the interface index. And I simply used what is in IP tables when we match the interface name. Therefore, IPSet at the moment matches the interface names. But it could be very easy to add to match the interface index. But in that case, of course, the interface must be static, and you cannot remove the interface and change it, because then you indices are changed, and therefore you, in that kind of system, you have to have static interfaces. That is the limitation. Yep.
Are there any goal to converge IPsec also to NF tables at some point in time, or?
I'm not aware of such a tool. No, I don't know about such a tool. No, no. You know, the features are not quite compatible. So of course you can find some corner cases when they are absolutely compatible, and it wouldn't be such too hard to create such a tool. But there is no such at the moment, as I know. Okay, thanks again.